Ham Radio Now, episode 182. I'm going to steal the name of the book. It's The World's Best Hobby. And here on the Skype line, over my shoulder is Dave Bell, W6AQ. Dave, welcome to Ham Radio Now. Pleasure to have you here.
Oh, Gary, thanks very much. I've been looking forward to this.
W6AQ, KN4AQ. Are we related?
We are proud members of the AQ Club, and I gather AQ cards, and I'm pleased to say I have yours as well.
Wow, you have a rare one. I haven't sent out QSL cards very much in a long time. Well, the reason that we're here is you're on your international book tour. How many stops have you made in how many countries on the book tour?
I've only had one country on the book tour so far. But I hope to improve that next summer.
So you are going to do some international stuff.
I am indeed. Okay. I'm sending a book to some of my European friends, and one of my New Zealand friends, and one of my Japanese friends. I haven't gotten around to that yet because I have to go to the post office to get them to calculate the postage. Or maybe it's all the same these days. I'm not even sure.
Probably the best way to do it is one of those one rate things, although I'm not sure how they work for international. In any case, the book in question is this one here, The World's Best Hobby, if I'm holding it up properly, a memoir by Dave Bell, W6AQ. And when did you write this? When did it come out?
This book came out at the very end of 2013. But it didn't get distributed then. It didn't get distributed until mid-2014 because I was having fights with the publisher. But we got those settled, and we got typos out and all that kind of stuff.
All right. So this is your website for the book, The World's Best Hobby. And that's the official cover, although I was noticing that on the ARL website, although the picture is pretty small, it's a different picture. Why are there two different pictures?
The ARL has the wrong cover picture. everything is exactly the same except the car. And on my cover picture, which is right here,
yeah,
you see that it's a yellow Thunderbird that I am washing as the guy walks by. And on the back cover of my book is actually a photograph that is
almost the same as
the front cover without the guy walking by.
So that's your house and your towers and everything.
That's my house and my towers and my antennas, yeah.
Okay, so that's not just some artist's conception. It's the real thing.
That's right.
All right. Well, let's talk about the book a little bit for a while, and then let's talk about a whole bunch of other things that we've got in common, this television stuff that we've done. In the television stuff, you are probably best known among hams for having produced some of the earliest and some of the most continuous television programs or movies, didn't call them videos because there was no videos back then, about ham radio. And the audience was primarily non-hams, I guess. You were producing these for the general public.
That's right. It's tough to make ham radio entertaining to the general public and understandable because it's such a complex hobby.
WA6RNG, this K6DUE. Byron, you still on frequency?
I've been trying to do that all my life. The first program I ever did about ham radio was in 1958, I think, or 57, for a television series I was working for at the time called Johns Hopkins File 7, and it was called The Ham's Wide World.
Yeah. I want to get into that in detail, but in a little bit later down the program. Because in looking through the book, you had the classic introduction to ham radio.
I think that's right, yeah.
As a young fella. The what what we often hear about as the classic introduction is a young ham, well, a young non-ham, a young ham wannabe, sees an antenna tower, knocks on the door, and is welcomed into this strange and wonderful world by a grizzled old, probably, white-bearded ham who proceeds to just about ignore him and start making contacts. Probably the most wonderful way anyone can be introduced to the hobby. And that's exactly what happened to you.
It is. He wasn't bearded and old at the time. He was probably 35.
But seemed old to you, I imagine.
Something like that, maybe 40. But he certainly was a veteran ham.
Who was that?
A big-time DXer. W8LIO. Jack Rotabar was my Elmer and ham radio, although at the time neither one of us called it an Elmer.
Yeah, the loudest in Ohio.
It was, northeastern corner of Ohio.
And what year did you first meet him, and how old were you?
I was probably 14 when I first met him, something like that.
What interest did you have that led you to knock on that door, to even be aware that that antenna was something you might be interested in?
I was listening to my 6-tube AC/DC Superhead AM radio in my bedroom, and all of a sudden the station I was listening to in Cleveland disappeared. Just plain disappeared from my radio, and I heard something that sounded like, I thought, what the hell is that? And I listened to that. And I listened on other radios that were in the house and my next door neighbors, and none of the other radios heard it. They being all non-AC/DC radios. Hams will understand why that is. I took the antenna off of the radio, aerial we called it at the time, which was a wire running out the window, so I could pick up the AM stations from Cleveland better. And I heard something that sounded like this, Shane on the IWAWIO. And he was really, really loud.
Loudest in Ohio.
He was all over the dial. I could tune the dial, and he was still there. And I thought, I'm going to find this W8LIO. And so I got on my bicycle and went to look. And I rode down West Main Street, and I saw this 85-foot tower in the backyard of a modest house on West Main Street. And I went up, it was summertime, I went up and knocked on the screen door. I saw this big man shouting into the microphone. And I was hearing J9AAI W8LIO live. And he just didn't even turn around. He just said, come in. And he pointed to a tired wicker chair in the corner, and I sat there while he called J9AAI for God knows how long, maybe hours.
That's Okinawa, right?
Okinawa, that is right.
Is that still the prefix for Okinawa?
Right after World War II.
Yeah, so that isn't the prefix for Okinawa anymore, because it's now a U.S. territory.
Yeah, that's right. It's not the prefix for Okinawa anymore. That one is gone, although I'm sure that Jack got a card from J9AI.
All right. So that was your introduction, but you didn't know what it was. You didn't have a clue.
That's absolutely right. However, I was a big, relatively husky guy in those days and very young and very eager, and Jack invited me back to help him put up his big beauty, which turned out to be a 33-element beam on 10 meters. And so for the next weekend, I spent two weekends, actually, we spent putting that thing up with the help of a lot of hams from probably a 60-mile radius of Andover. It was a square corner. It looked like that. The reflectors were all up and down the sides. And out here was the driven element. And as I say in my book, it doesn't matter how driven that element was, it wasn't nearly as driven as Jack was.
Yeah. Even today, 33-element 10-meter beam doesn't sound right. It will cause hams to squinch up their face and say, what? How many elements?
That's right. Not everybody believed him when he told them that it was a 33 element beam, but a lot of people did because he was so loud.
But he didn't last very long.
It didn't last even a week. A huge wind came through and took the beam and the top 20 feet of the tower down. And that was the end of the 33 element beam. Although Jack didn't seem to even mind, because in the words of his friend Sam Harris, if your antenna didn't blow down last winter, it wasn't big enough. And his was obviously big enough because it blew down.
So a classic introduction to the world of ham radio. And this is a theme that I'm going to attempt to weave throughout the course of our conversation. It was a very slow introduction to the world of ham radio. You didn't get it all at once. You got it in very tiny bits and pieces.
It was the only reason it took me so long to get a ham license, which was years, was that I had to learn the code 13 words a minute. And it didn't come naturally to me. My Elmer mentor was a phone man running high power. So what I wanted to be was a phone man running high power. And he gave me, in fact, his J38 key, which he never used, to practice on. And I still have it.
Is that sitting behind you anyplace? Is that you? Can you reach it?
I'm sorry?
Is it sitting behind you someplace you can reach? That J38?
Yeah.
Yeah, let's take a look at that.
It's right here.
Okay, because not everybody's going to know what a J38 is. So just a...
It's a straight... It's just a key. You push it down, you make a dash. You just hit it like that, and you make a dot, and it's dashes and dots all handmade.
Yeah, just a plain old straight key. But when I'm saying that you got your education in ham radio in very slow bits and pieces, at least from reading the first couple chapters of the book, there was no rush. He didn't tell you everything there was to know about ham radio in the first 12 hours that he knew you. Yeah, he told you almost nothing. He told you he was going to put up a big antenna.
He didn't tell me much. He didn't tell me much about ham radio at all. It was all by example. He did say, you can come over and watch me operate anytime you want to, and I took advantage of that. And I discovered that his next-door neighbor was a high school pal of mine, a Boy Scout pal of mine, who had been out of town when we put up the 33-element beam out on vacation, who was studying for his ham license. And he was actually as helpful, if not more so, than Jack. He was my own age. He was a year older than I was. And his name was Whitey Taylor. Hal Taylor is his. He got rid of Whitey when he became an adult. But Hal Taylor was his name, is his name. And he is W8CY today, and he's still on the air.
W6AQ was not your initial call sign, right?
No, my original call sign was W8GUE, which Jack immediately called GUI, and let it go at that. So he would come on the air occasionally after I got my license and call CQ for a while and have some conversations, and then he would say, is GUI around here?
Where did W6AQ come from? Is that a vanity?
W6AQ... Let's see, in 1975, I realized that the FCC was giving out two-letter suffixes for hams who had been hams for 25 years, I think, or so.
Yeah, and had your extra.
Who had an extra class license. And the only difficulty with that was I didn't have an extra class license because I didn't know the code 20 words a minute. But I decided that I really wanted to have a two-letter suffix labeling me officially as an old-timer. And I learned the relearned the code, 25 words a minute. And it took me 1 year to do that every night for a half an hour, listening to code practice, listening to tapes while I was out on my daily jog, cassette tapes in those days. And I managed to pass the 20 word a minute code test, which is told about in the book. And I'd always wanted a call sign starting with A for some reason. And this was the AQ was the only one that was available, and I applied for it and I got it.
Okay, so you were able to specify AQ.
I was able to. I sent in a whole list of potential calls, and AQ was at the top, and okay. I got it.
For me, for anybody, if anybody's curious, it was just a purely sequential FCC issue. My original call was WN9NSO, and then WA9NSO as a general. And after I left Chicago, I traveled around a bit and ended up in Knoxville, Tennessee, and thought, well, I think I'll get a call sign reflective of the part of the country I was living in. So once again, just checked the box at renewal time for a new call sign, sequentially issued, and KN4AQ popped up. And I was actually kind of delighted to get a novice call.
But that's an extra class call, is it not?
It's an advanced, because I was only, advanced at the time, but 2x2. With the KN as the novice and the AQ, the two-letter call, being part of the advanced structure. So it was a novice advanced. I was delighted.
I think it's a terrific call that you have.
The AQ didn't mean anything to me in particular, but...
It did not. I will show you something on my wall, however. Hang on 1 second.
The African Queen.
Yeah, let me get up to that.
I watched that a couple of weeks ago.
Did you?
Yeah, because I'd never seen it before. And I thought, AQ, I have to watch that movie.
When I got that call sign... When I got the AQ, African Queen is what I thought of immediately, because it's one of my favorite movies. In fact, a lot of it was shot right down in a park that's very close to where I live.
It wasn't shot in Africa?
Some of it was.
So, 'cause I'm shocked.
No, it wasn't all shot in Africa.
I know how that works, but
I think that Humphrey Bogart and Katharine Hepburn got tired of Africa fairly quickly.
Yeah,
but it was—I thought it was a terrific picture.
It was interesting. What year did that come out? Do you remember?
Oh, I don't. I don't. It was 40 years ago at least.
Yeah, I mean, it was a classic of old school movie making. They don't make movies like that anymore.
Older than that. It's copyright 1952, United Artists.
Yeah. It's, it's in an old movie-making style. Nothing serious in the way of special effects, except for practical effects, like a few things blowing up here and there.
There were no special effects. John Huston directed that. And... I think he was a really tough old guy, frankly.
Yep.
So the actors were probably pleased as hell to get back to Hollywood.
I mean, any kid today with a decent phone could make a movie more sophisticated than that.
They're more sophisticated, but are they any better?
Yeah, technically more sophisticated, but in terms of story, yeah, the story is classic.
So, the story is absolutely a classic.
Yep. So, speaking of story, the book, World's Best Hobby, it's a memoir. It starts very much ham radio, but it doesn't stay ham radio. It weaves your life and all the things that happened in your life. After the first couple chapters, ham radio's, it's not left behind, but it just becomes a part of what's going on.
That's right. Unlike a lot of people who got busy in their work, and I certainly got busy in my work, I never left ham radio behind. I always was on the air at least some of the time. So every chapter has some ham radio in it. But I've realized that my business, which is producing television programs of one kind and another, interested people out in the hinterlands probably more than ham radio did. So I included a lot of the stuff that I did for a living. And I also included my family, who suffered a little bit from my ham radio interest, I suspect. And certainly suffered from the amount of hours that I put in producing television programs, which is not an easy job.
No. And I haven't had a chance to read all of the book yet. You had sent me a copy, but it hasn't arrived yet, the physical copy. Let me take a look at the web stuff that I've got here. The book is available from the ARL. You can get it there. I also... that's not what I wanted to see. It's available on Amazon in paperback form. And when I first saw this Amazon page, I looked around hard and I said, well, it doesn't appear to be available electronically as Kindle. But after looking a little bit farther, I did find that it could be a Kindle download. And I don't know if this bothers you very much or affects you at all, but if you buy it from Kindle as a paperback, it's 1864 on the ARL's website that I keep grabbing the wrong one. It's about $23. As a Kindle, it's $4. And I got a special deal. I think I got it for like $2.50. So how does that affect you as a writer, having something like that happen?
Well, how does it affect me as a writer? I don't like the Kindle version, frankly. I don't know who didn't do a good job putting it up as a Kindle version. But if you have a crappy old Kindle like I do, I have a prototype Kindle, the cartoons don't come out well. And some of the photographs, which are 60 or 70 years old, don't come out particularly well either. So I'm not a big fan of the Kindle version, even though it's cheap. I mean, that's one advantage of it. It's cheap. I don't know how Amazon gets its books. I will tell you one quick thing about Amazon that I've discovered. Amazon does not stockpile books, so when you order a book from Amazon, it goes on back order automatically. At least that's what I think.
Probably depends on the book.
They order one copy from the publisher, and they get it, and they send it to you. How they can sell it so cheaply is beyond me. I don't know.
This is the, it's not actually a Kindle that I'm looking at it on. It's a Nexus 7 typical tablet. There's one of the pictures that you're talking about. This is the diagram that looks like the actual diagram of the 33 element beam. But if I blow it up, it makes a pretty good looking picture.
It does indeed.
Yeah.
It does indeed. It doesn't look bad at all. On my Kindle, it doesn't look nearly that good.
Yeah, so it can be a little bit better. This is the actual drawing that your mentor handed you the first day you were there?
That's right. I have been a pack rat all my life. I've moved all over the country and world, and all of this stuff has somehow gotten stored and caught up with me when I came to California.
So you found it. I'll bet that was special.
Right. It was. And I've made a lot of speeches in my life. I love speaking to ham radio crowds. I'm a huge proselytizer of ham radio, as you are. And I just can't understand why everybody isn't interested in ham radio.
Well, I make it a point of being sure that I'm aware that not everybody is going to be interested. So if I'm talking about it to people who aren't hams, it's not like, and when do you want to get your license? I try not to do that. But it's hard. It's hard not to. And a lot of hams fall into that trap. And that's something I want to talk about as we go along and look through your career and the things that you've done with the ham radio movies. It took you a while to get your license. You were saying because the Morse code was a hurdle for you. And I just about gotten up to the part in the book where you had passed your test, and shortly after the FCC came up with the novice license. So you
it was just months. It was months. I mean, I got my license, and they announced, as soon as I got my license, they announced the novice license.
Yep.
So, I would have had a novice license in 1948 if they'd had a novice license then. As it was, I didn't get my general class license, which they called Class B, I think, until 1951, early in 51.
So you lost about 3 years.
Yeah. I had a good time, though. I was an SWL. I had an SWL card, which one copy survives, which is in my book. And I learned an immense amount of geography. I got the best grades in geography in high school. And I got a lot of cards from DX stations, all of which said, "See you on the air."
So they were waiting for you to get your ham license. As an SWL, you had, what, an S-38 Hallicrafters receiver? Was that the first receiver you got?
I had the first real radio I had was an HQ-129X from Hammerland.
Okay.
Fairly big radio, but I didn't realize at the time, but my family was the rich family in the town of 1,000 people. And when I showed this interest in ham radio, my mother said to me that it was going to be a tough job to get a license. And my father said to me, it's going to be a lot of fun. They were both right.
So in the couple of years that took between getting interested and getting on the air, you shortwave listened?
Yeah, it was 3 years probably. Yeah. By the time I got on the air, I had the HQ-129X. I had modified a couple of surplus radio, World War II surplus radios that actually transmitted. I borrowed an ART-13, which was a Collins military radio, from my mentor, Jack. Turned out that it wasn't his, so he needed it back at some point. And the guy that loaned it to him asked for it back. And I had built a 500-watt amplifier in what was my shack. And I took out radios and television sets all over the neighborhood.
You had no electronics education, any formal education at all. Going into this, you knew nothing, and you started picking things up from Jack and the other hams in town.
That's right. I didn't know anything about it. I still have never had an electronics class of any kind. For some reason, I did not get a ham radio, an electronics merit badge from the Boy Scouts, and I can't figure out why that is. Except I think you had to know memorize the Morse code for that, although I'm not sure about that. Hal Taylor, who was in my Boy Scout troop, got a merit badge, so he automatically started ahead of me.
So they were offering it in your area, but not something that you got.
They were. They offered an electronics merit badge, but I, for some reason, didn't take it. My patience with scouting ran out when I got to be a life scout, so I think I just didn't make it that far.
All right. So the Morse code thing was kind of interesting because you eventually were able to master it well enough. Sounds like it's never been a big deal for you. You've never been really fascinated by Morse code.
You know, it's interesting. When I had to learn the Morse code 20 words a minute, in order to get my extra class license, I developed an interest in Morse code for the very first time. And now I would think that probably half of my contacts, a third to a half of my contacts, are on Morse code. I'm still not really great at it. I send at about 16 to 18 words a minute. And when some guy comes back to me at 40 words a minute, I just...
I think people have said that when you cross about the 20 word a minute barrier or threshold, that that's when it becomes somewhat conversational and more fun and less work.
That happened to me. It's much more fun now that I can actually copy 20 words a minute. 25 words a minute I can probably copy. In a contest, I can probably copy 35 words a minute as long as the contest exchange is short.
Yeah, routine stuff. Something that you know the formula, you know the format it's going to come in. So then you're just concentrating on the specific couple of letters or a couple of numbers.
That is exactly right.
Yeah, and that's probably probably part of the reason why 5.9 became the universal signal report. So it's nothing, you don't have to get any new data from that. You know what's going to come.
Of course, you don't even need to know the code to get an extra class license at all.
Yep. But when you were first studying it and when you first went for your first test, one of the more interesting short anecdotes from the book is that you copied everything 100% and failed the test.
Well, yeah, that's right. I copied everything 100% except every time they sent a comma, I put down a dash, because in ham radio casual conversation, nobody ever sends a comma. What they send is a double dash. They are similar, but for some reason, I had never in my entire life written down a comma. I had always just double dash. So I didn't have enough sequential letters to pass the test before they ran into what should have been a comma, but was a dash.
Yep. So a bitter disappointment and a lesson learned, and back to some more studying. How long between the first try and the second try?
The time between the first try and the second try was interrupted by the death of my father, I'm sorry to say, which was a shock to everybody, including me. Totally unexpected. So it was probably close to a year before I went back to take the test again. And of course, the second time I took the test, like virtually everybody who takes it a second time, I passed it.
Yeah, and I guess we should mention, because there's a lot of new hams that are thinking, well, they just go to a club meeting and take a test or to a ham fest. That wasn't the case back then. You had to travel to Cleveland, and they gave the test how many times a year in Cleveland?
My parents owned a dry goods store, so they went into Cleveland about once every 2 months, and I would go in with them. But there were certainly no ham clubs in any place close to Andover, Ohio, a town of 1,000 people then and 1,000 people now. But there are still a couple of hams in Andover. In fact, I talked to one relatively recently. And the second cousin of W8LIO got interested in ham radio all on his own. And he got W8LIO as his call.
Oh, okay. So Jack had passed away.
Jack had died by then. Yeah, this is just recently.
Okay. Well, interesting. Did he do that on purpose?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Jack was a well-known ham in northeastern Ohio.
A legend.
When he said he was the loudest in Ohio, he wasn't just whistling Dixie.
Okay. So what I was getting at was the when you went to take your test, you had to do it before the FCC.
What?
You had to take your test in front of the FCC. Not a volunteer examiner session.
Oh no! It was at the FCC's gray office in Cleveland.
And if people think a VE test is nerve wracking, a test in front of FCC employees, government employees, especially if you're a teenager, is totally dreaded.
It's much more intimidating, I can tell you. It's just really, really intimidating. It was, of all of the experiences I've had, the most nervous time in my entire life. And when I passed the extra class license exam, that also was at an FCC office in 1975 or 6, in Long Beach, California. And the office looked exactly the same as the one in Cleveland.
probably a template. Yeah, I took my general twice. For me, it was the opposite deal. The Morse code was never a problem. And although I was nervous when I was taking the test, I passed it the first time. But I didn't pass the written test. I hadn't studied hard enough. And I went down, and in those days, this was 1965, and the FCC office I went to was downtown Chicago. They gave a test every Friday. So in a big city like that, we were lucky. We didn't have to wait maybe, you know, four times a year or twice a year or something, that a lot of smaller towns got their tests. So I was able to go down in 30 days. You had to wait a minimum of 30 days, and you could take the test again. Pass the code test again pretty easily, and then pass the theory on the second try. So, I remember well going down for the FCC exam. And then I had one more in ham radio, the advanced class, which came probably 5 or 6 years later. Never took the extra from the FCC. I got my extra in 2000 from a VE test up in Baltimore. And at a magic time where you could take the written test for the extra before April 15th and file it after April 15th. And what happened on April 15th, 2000, was the code requirement dropped from 20 words a minute to 5 words a minute. And so I never had to learn 20 words a minute. And even though it was never a problem for me, it was also never a joy. So my code speed has suffered, and I don't use it much.
There are today on the air, as you know, slow code nets. They're not really nets. There are frequencies where people are sending the Morse code 8 to 12 words a minute, and they have conversations at 8 to 12 words a minute. I think it's just wonderful.
Yeah. I have a short story that I tell about Morse code. And I was listening to a couple of old codgers. They were talking, it's probably on 75-meter phone. They weren't on code. And they were complaining that in that CW contact, they were interrupted by somebody who was sending very slowly. And they were down at the low end of the band. And they were just really irritated. They were mad at this guy that interrupted them sending very slowly, the bottom end of the band. And I'm thinking, and this is after Morse code was eliminated as a requirement. So it was somebody who was just learning. And I'm thinking, what are you guys complaining about? Here you have a ham trying to contact you on Morse code, sending slowly, but absolutely voluntarily, and you're complaining about it? I mean, where were these guys coming from? What was their problem? So they should have been offering to buy the guy lunch, not complaining. So their problem was he was in the bottom 25 kilohertz of the band, someplace where you're supposed to be sending fast, and he wasn't. So,
well, that's bull.
Yeah,
you can send slow any place you want to. Obviously,
you can. Yeah,
I will tell you my story about fast code. My friend Don Lyle and I were out in at 9M6. In Malaysia for a contest, a AWRL CW contest. Neither Don nor I knew CW particularly well, even though I'd passed my extra class exam by then. And so we were making contacts from 9M6 at about 18 words a minute, I would think. And some really loud signal came on at 40 words a minute calling us, and neither one of us could copy his call sign, which is really unusual. So I just ignored him. We tuned around a little bit and talked to some other people who would send at our speed. And then I came back to him later, and the Morse code program I was using went from 5 words a minute to 60 words a minute. So I cranked it up to 60 words a minute and sent 9M6V to him, and he sent back a question mark, meaning that he could copy and send 40 words a minute of contest stuff, but he couldn't do 60. And I kept coming back to him at 60. And I don't remember now whether I ever slowed down for him or not, but he really annoyed the hell out of me.
So, and he doesn't sound like he was learning his lesson at all.
What's that?
Doesn't sound like he was learning the lesson at all about the speed.
He wasn't learning a lesson, that's for sure.
No. Well, fortunately, that's, I think, far more the exception than the rule. Like most hams, CW is the gentleman's mode.
It absolutely is. I have seen so many hams slow down for me, and I really appreciate it. And nobody seems to mind. I mean, they can do lots of other things while they're listening to me send to them. In fact, the
oh, have lunch.
The first contest, so-called contest of the year, is going to be straight key night, so-called, when I use my J38, which I showed you, pounding out dashes and dots in the old-fashioned way, talking to other people using their J38s or straight keys, and I incidentally don't know why they're called straight keys, to make contests.
I think we may have lost a little bit. The Skype signal is dropping out, and it seems to be coming back. So straight key night.
I hope I'm not running out of battery on my new computer.
Hope not. Straight key night. Many people will see this before then. Everybody who watches before then. That is what, New Year's Day night, or is it New Year's Eve?
It's New Year's Eve and New Year's Day.
Okay, so starting New Year's Eve on to New Year's Day, straight key night. Basically sending by moving your hand up and down like this, not moving it back and forth like that.
That's right.
Or punching on a keyboard like that.
Yes, there's no keyboards involved in straight key night.
That's 60 words a minute. Shame on you.
Or 60 words a minute.
All right, let's go back to your story a little bit more. When you finally got your ham license, you were in college.
I was.
And you had no idea what you wanted to be when you grew up.
No, for a while I thought I was going to be an actor, and then I realized that that really isn't much of a job. If you weren't a star, you had people telling you what to do all of the time, and I didn't really like that. Then I thought I was going to be a director of theater. There aren't many directors of theaters who are making any money that I know of and knew of at the time. And television was big then. I had actually had a television set in my room in college, and I decided I was going to go into the television business. That's what I did.
You just, without experience in it, I mean, you had some interest in performance, the performing arts, one way or another.
One of the reasons that I went to Hiram College in Ohio, in addition to being only 50 miles from home, was that they had a showboat that ran up and down the Ohio, Monongahela, and other rivers in along southern Ohio, some very small tributaries of the Ohio River, putting on old-time vaudeville and melodramas for the townspeople. And we actually made it to Pittsburgh and docked under the 6th Street Bridge on the Allegheny River, and we stayed there for 2 months to solid sell-out houses the whole time. And that's what convinced me that you could make money in show business.
Yeah, I need to stick in my my actor joke. Movies or television or anything. It's like, I'm an actor. Oh, yeah? What restaurant?
That's it, all right.
If someone... Jokes can't be explained, but the idea is most actors make their living waiting tables and at a restaurant. So so you wanted to get into showbiz, and you decided on television. So how do you act on deciding to be in television?
Well, I thought I was going to get into the dramatic end of television because that's what I'd been doing all that time. But my first job in television was for Johns Hopkins producing documentaries for this Johns Hopkins File 7 program, which was live television, incidentally, in those days. There was no videotape, if you can believe it. Today, there is no videotape either.
For another reason. Johns Hopkins is a university. What were they making television for? Was it training stuff for students, or what were they into?
It started out life as a Dumont Network program, and when ABC bought Dumont, they kept Johns Hopkins File 7, probably because it was cheap, it was educational, it made the FCC happy, and it didn't cost much.
Where was it produced? Where did they do that?
It was produced at WJZ in Baltimore, and it was broadcast in color in the late 1950s. Nobody had a color television set, of course, but WJZ was owned by Westinghouse, which was playing nicely with RCA, which made color television cameras.
All right, so you're in Baltimore, and this was how often was the program broadcast? Was it once a week?
It was broadcast once a week on Sunday afternoon prior to football taking over the world.
Okay, so not the hot spot of television. It wasn't a primetime evening show.
No, it certainly wasn't a hot spot. And that first ham radio program that I did, the original Ham's Wide World, God knows how many people saw it, but there was never a rerun of it. Although I discovered, just when I was writing my book, I discovered that Johns Hopkins actually bought Kinescopes, which is a black and white film recording of a television program. They bought kinescopes of a lot of the Johns Hopkins File 7 programs, including the Ham's Wide World. And they gave me permission to use that original Ham's Wide World from the late 50s in what I call the ARRL film collection, which are all of the films, most of the films, if not all of the films, that I've had to do with regarding ham radio on one DVD. And if the ARRL is on the ball, they will, yes, there it is right there, they will include it as a package with my book.
Well, that would be a good idea. Don't know if they will. Yeah. They're $16 for the DVD. I don't know why I don't own that, but I should get it really fast, because these are all programs that you have done. Ham's Wide World, This Is Ham Radio, Moving Up to Amateur Radio, The World of Amateur Radio, Ham Radio Today, and the original Ham's Wide World. And that's the one Johns Hopkins. And they're all on this DVD.
Right. What do they want for it? $15?
$15.95.
It's a bargain.
Yeah, it's cheap at twice the price. That's something I do want to talk about. There's all kinds of things I want to talk about that we'll try to squeeze in here and there. And maybe I'll go for this now. I started getting interested in producing ham radio video stuff about 10 years ago, when equipment got inexpensive enough that I could acquire enough to make something halfway decent and put it out there. And I thought, well, I don't know if it'd be a business. It's probably not going to be a business, but let's give this a try and see what happens. And so I made some documentaries, pretty good ones, in my humble estimation. And Jack said if you find somebody who's modest, it's probably because they've got a lot to be modest about. I think that's a quote from the book. I will humble brag that I think I made some pretty good documentaries.
You know something? It's very interesting, and I've been thinking about this a lot lately. Basically, hams are cheap. They will spend $200,000 on ham equipment for their shack, another $50,000 for antennas, and they'll give the ARRL a $100 gift once a year and think that they're really being generous.
Yeah. Well, where I'm going with this is... what's your experience with hams and ham stuff in the more traditional media or video television programs about ham radio? My impression is it's a non sequitur. It's a non-starter. They don't get it. If it's not in QST or CQ or the old 73, it's not ham radio. They don't get it. Did hams get the videos you were making?
Well, you know, I as you pointed out earlier, almost all of my films were made for television, and television, of course, is what they call a mass media. I'm not sure how mass it is anymore. If I were doing it today, I would probably start a YouTube channel and do it all on YouTube. Is all of your stuff on YouTube?
Yeah. Yeah, everything on Ham Radio Now is youtube.com/HamRadioNow. So, yeah, we're a big YouTube channel.
And it's all
we're
free.
We're a little YouTube channel. Yeah, and it's all free. And I beg for money. I got, speaking of $100 contributions, you know, not the ARRL, but just the other day, the PayPal thing chinked in, and there was a ham sending me $100 for doing what I do. So, well, it may not be a big deal for ARRL. It's a big deal for Ham Radio Now.
I think that people that watch this program ought to contribute to it.
Well, yeah, and a lot do. Probably I'm doing better as a contribution thing than way above average.
That's good. That's good.
PBS, of course, which exists on contributions and corporate stuff. I don't have any of the corporate stuff. But their contributions, well, people say like it's like 4%, and I'm probably in more like 10 or 15% of the people who really watch. So that's great. It's just not a business.
Yeah, the ham radio manufacturers, I think, all run a very tight margin, and they profit margin, and they probably have a limited amount of advertising funds. And when it comes down to something like Ham Radio Now, you have to be an advertising manager who watches it all the time in order to get their attention.
Yeah, and I don't have enough of an audience to make it economically viable on that. The thing that any advertiser is aware of, they call it a cost per thousand. How much are you going to spend per thousand people who look, who view the program? And it's in the somewhere between under a buck and for a really good show, maybe a buck or so. Which if you've got millions of people, they're spending millions of dollars. But I've got a couple thousand people, and no one is going to spend that kind of money. So I'd be in the pennies per thousand, and it really wouldn't be worth doing. I make more just asking people to send me money. So you're right. Your programs were aimed at the general public, not specifically at hams. So you weren't looking for hams to get really into the programs. I think when they saw them, they got excited. When they did see them, they got pretty enthusiastic about them. But they're not buying the DVD off the shelf faster than ARRL can keep it in stock.
You know, I tried to get stars in my programs. I did one, and Dick Van Dyke was the narrator of it and appeared in it very briefly. A lovely guy. He never became a ham. He should have. His manager was a ham, which is how I got him.
And Byron Paul is Dick Van Dyke's partner, which explains how I got involved in a show about ham radio.
And then, of course, I did two films, actually, with King Hussein of Jordan in them. One about a spaceship coming over, where he talked to W5LFL as he went over and disappeared over the horizon. That was exciting. And then the other one where he just explained his interest in ham radio.
Delta Kilo to Oscar Charlie. This is Japan. Yankee 1. Juliet Yankee 1. Good afternoon to you, my friend. 5x9, go.
Yeah, okay, we'll find your majesty. Your 5x9 likewise into West Berlin.
And I did one with Barry Goldwater.
Now, this is an amateur radio station in Arizona. And we have your husband, the captain, on the other end of this hookup.
I directed Walter Cronkite in one.
An amateur radio is the only fail-safe communication system in the world.
So I like to have some recognizable names in my films, which you can do if you're doing them for television, if you're doing them for YouTube these days, or 5 years ago, tougher to get.
Yeah, it depends on who you are. If you've got the contacts already and can show an audience, YouTube probably wouldn't be that hard to bring people into. You didn't get these people just because you were on television. You got them because there were ham connections that you could work if you didn't know these people already. And I think in some cases you already did.
Well, the television connection was essential because it guaranteed a sizable audience. It might not have been huge, but at least it was measured in the thousands, if not the tens of, it was probably the tens of thousands. And so when you said to King Hussein's advisor that it's going to be on NBC or whatever it's going to be on, made a difference. Yeah, if I was just making a film for the ARRL, I don't know whether I would have gotten King Hussein or not, although he was a very affable guy and probably would have done it.
Yeah. So you're making the first show for the Johns Hopkins series that you were working on. By the way, how do you go from television wannabe to a producer of a network program in one step?
I went to Syracuse University and got a master's degree in television.
Okay, so you had some chops.
What I discovered at Syracuse was that the dean of the television school got all the job offers, and there were job offers in those days from networks and stations for help. And he would look and see who got the best grades in the master's program that I was in, and he would recommend that person, whether that person had any talent in that area or not. So I went out of my way to get the best grades of anybody in my class of 25 people, which I did, and the job offer that came in first was from ABC for the Johns Hopkins program.
So you were working for ABC, not for Johns Hopkins. You're an actual ABC producer.
Yeah.
And now here's a question that everybody asks who's tangentially familiar with television and wants to know a little bit more about it. What does a producer do?
What does a producer do? A producer is like a contractor in a building. The producer deals with the architect, who would be the writer, deals with the builder, who would be the director, and all of the unions, all of those kinds of people, and tries to keep the damn thing on track. Basically, what a producer does is try to deliver to the buyer at a very minimum what the buyer expects. And with a little bit of luck, you deliver more than the buyer expects, and everybody is happy.
So you're not the actor, you're not the writer.
I've done some movies, and I've dealt with actors, and I enjoy dealing with actors. I like actors. Actors are interesting people. And what I didn't realize while I was in college is that actors are really, really responsible for their own characters. You see some wonderful acting these days, but generally speaking, the actor has created that persona. And that's what comes out. And the director keeps the actors from stumbling over each other. That's very unfair to the directors. And I am a director.
Yeah, okay, so let me show people just a little bit here. IMDb, the Internet Movie Database, is where all the big shots are. And you have an IMDb page. You've run a Primetime Emmy, it says here, and have five other nominations. There's some TV shows and movies that you've been on, and then it goes on to the list of the programs that you've had credits for. Where would you rank yourself in the general category of television producers and directors?
Very minor character, unfortunately. I try to become a movie producer, and I discovered quickly that I didn't have the contacts to be a movie producer, so I pretty much stuck to being a television producer. My agent at the time, William Morris, didn't want me to become a movie producer because I was making them so much money in the reality.
William Morris is a big name.
And I was very big in the reality business in the early days of reality television. My company started Unsolved Mysteries, if you go back that far. And that program was on for years and years and years. But what I wanted to do was produce movies. And the first really good movie that I produced, well, actually, I produced Nadia, which we shot in Yugoslavia. And I didn't have any idea how to produce a movie, but I learned how to produce one very quickly when I got started on Nadia. Which little girls between 8 and 12 probably devoured. They devoured that movie. It unfortunately is not available now. I mean, you can buy bootleg copies of it, which are awful. And I'm trying to get that movie back. But I haven't had any success getting it back from Tribune, who owns it. And Do You Remember Love? With Joanne Woodward and Richard Kiley was my claim to fame in the television movie business, which won an Emmy and a Peabody.
How do you make the step up to getting a movie like that from what you were describing as a, you know, career sort of in the middle of the road?
Well, it's a very long story, which is kind of tedious. I tried it on all the networks. I had a treatment which was just dynamite. And the treatment is 8 or 10 pages of what the movie is going to be about. And the treatment was terrific. I tried to sell it to every single network, and none of them would buy it because they said it was such a downer. It was about Alzheimer's disease. First one about Alzheimer's disease. At the time, I was doing a television series with Bristol-Myers, and I took it to Bristol-Myers see if they would sponsor it. And the head of Bristol-Myers Advertising said to me that if I could get Joanne Woodward to play the lead, they would come up with the money for the movie. And so I, one way or another, got it to Joanne Woodward. She wrote me a handwritten note that said, if the script is as good as the treatment, I'll do it. And I got the script written, and the script was better than the treatment, and Joanne did it. And she suggested Richard Kiley to play her husband. And Richard was one of the nicest, sweetest guys that I'd ever met in my life. And it was a hell of a good movie, actually. And it's going to be available from Amazon one of these days, if I ever get around to that.
Did you know Joanne Woodward? Or was it a cold call?
Cold call. I actually had a friend of mine who knew her contact her for me.
So you needed a good script. Now, you weren't the writer, or did you write this one?
No, it was written by a woman named Vicky Paddock, the first script she'd ever written.
But she did good.
Yeah.
And she did good for you.
It was just a remarkably good script, and we got a good director, and it ran on CBS, who had turned it down twice, sponsored by Bristol-Myers. And when I won the Emmy for that, I thanked the CBS sales department for allowing the movie to go on the air. I think I totally pissed off everybody at CBS. It wasn't a smart thing for me to do, but I enjoyed it.
So meanwhile, back at Ham Radio, which I vaguely remember talking about some time ago.
Yeah.
You did the first ham radio program that you did back with the Johns Hopkins File 7.
Right.
How did you decide to do a ham radio show?
I'd always been a promoter of ham radio, even when I was young. And I talked the executive producer into doing it. And I can't even remember how I managed to do that, because it was certainly off the topic. Fortunately for me, there was a ham radio club at Johns Hopkins, so we made a slight tie there, although they didn't show up in the program. But it just caught his fancy, and he gave me a go-ahead to do it.
Was this, so I haven't seen it yet, and it's not on YouTube, so it's not something we can see until we all get the DVD from the ARL. Was it a talking head show, or was it a field produced, and you go out and shoot all the stuff and then bring it back and edit it for weeks?
It was both. I was lucky. At the time, a couple of really young hams had bounced a 15-meter radio signal off the trail of a satellite going by that had ionized the atmosphere. And an eminence no less than John Krause, W8JK, confirmed that that's what they had done. So it was a headline in the New York Daily News. It was the entire front page. Two young hams did this. And I had one of them on the program showing us what he had done. Because in those days, bouncing something off an ionized trail in the sky was big, big, big news. And particularly on 15 meters. I'm still not certain that that's what happened, but John Krause thinks so. Who am I to tell him nay? And I had Sam Harris, who I'd known from Ohio, as a star on the show. He was by then W1FZJ, I think. He was W8UKS when I knew him in Ohio. And I'll tell you a quick story about Sam. He worked for Brush Development Company. He lived in Burton, Ohio, in a basement house on top of a hill. He had a 180-foot tower in his backyard. He was a very good friend of Jack's, of course. W8LIO and W8UKS both worked for Brush Development. And I stopped there once, and Sam was at his kitchen table putting together circuits using little top hats that had three wires coming out of them. And I said to him, "What are those?" He says, "Those are transistors," he said. "They're going to replace tubes someday, and I'm going to patent circuits using them." And that's exactly what he was doing.
Wow.
Way ahead of his time.
So this 15-meter thing, I mean, we think of bouncing signals off of ionized trails more for meteors than burning up satellites. And we think of that as something that's done on 2 meters and maybe 70 centimeters or 220, but not HF. So, yeah, who knows what the real propagation was. But we'll go with the experts. So that was just a lucky break for you that suddenly there's the news headlines on a topic that you have been pitching to do a program on. So you get the green light, as they say in showbiz.
Luck is better than talent any day.
Combination is an awesome, unstoppable force. When you did that program, and I'm going to tie back to something that I was aiming for early in the program, where you got your start in little dribs and drabs. When you're doing that program and the rest of the programs that you were doing, did you have in mind how difficult it is to introduce a big, broad topic like ham radio to the public in one gulp?
Half hour? Yeah, it was a non-commercial half hour. Yes, I'd figured out how to do that with some other programs that were really tough. Like I did the first reconstructive plastic surgery program from the Johns Hopkins Hospital that had ever been done. And I realized how tough that was going to be to do, and it was tough, but I shot a lot of film. We had a Bell & Howell 16-millimeter camera with three lenses on it. Silent, of course, it didn't shoot sound. Because it made so much noise, you wouldn't have heard anything but the camera. But I shot a lot of film and edited it in the basement of our little editing room there at Johns Hopkins. And so I filled my shows with as much entertainment away from the studio stuff as I possibly could. And the ham radio conversations that we performed in the studio were all recorded. So I knew exactly what the guys in the DX stations were going to say. And so my ham host for the show, Doc Krieg, knew exactly what he was going to say because he was talking to a recording.
Yeah, they're on camera talking to a tape recorder.
That's right.
You cheated, but it is difficult to make real radio conversations cooperate. I've tried that. It's It's very hard to do.
For one thing, if the station you're in is running any power and you're running a good tape recorder, the power will destroy that tape recorder. I had a Nagra tape recorder that I did most of my documentaries with, and even a 100-watt station would just destroy that tape recorder.
Yeah, so it would get in, a sideband or AM signal will get in and just obliterate the sound that you're recording. People don't know what a Nagra is, but it's basically a sophisticated reel-to-reel tape recorder that synchronizes to a film camera and records the sound half of what's going on when you've got a film camera that's quiet enough to let you do that. So I'm curious how much of the technology of broadcasting you got yourself interested in. You were in the production end of things, and I think we most of us know that broadcast engineering is filled with hams. There's hams all over the place in engineering, but you weren't in engineering. You were in producing. And how much of the technology did you get your fingers into when you were working with all this sophisticated stuff?
You know, I was interested in the technology, but and I was delighted when videotape came along, of course. And I was delighted when videotape editing came along. I was delighted when digital came along. But I never really got into it other than using it. I figured out how to use it. Every time I went to a new studio or network, I would let it be known that I was a ham. And sure enough, one of the engineers for sure was a ham. In fact, one of the ones that became a friend of mine was Lenore Jensen's husband, Bob Jensen, who was an audio man par excellence at NBC.
You made your first television program about ham radio for Studio 7, or for File 7, for John Hopkins and ABC. How long was it before you made your second one? And were you sitting around figuring out what to do in that second one?
Interestingly enough, the second one was also called The Ham's Wide World, because I didn't have any idea that the original Ham's Wide World existed on a kinescope. So how long was it? It was probably 15 years, something like that. It was a long time. I had to get established in the television industry. I was in the local television business out here in Los Angeles for a long time before I started doing network and syndicated programs. And interestingly enough, the ARRL contacted me at the Southern California DX Club and said, "Are you the guy that made the Ham's Wide World for Johns Hopkins program?" No, none of them had ever seen it, but they all heard about it, and they wanted a film about ham radio. And at that time, there was the Southwestern Division director of the ARRL was a guy named John Griggs, W6KW, the only person licensed to run 6KW, according to him.
According to him.
And it took him a year to cajole and massage the ARRL into a budget big enough for me to handle and to make a film for them. And that's exactly what happened. And after that film, which ran extensively on television, I mean, it just, in those days, the television stations had to run free films, so-called, which were public service. And I can't tell you how many times the Ham's Wide World ran on television stations all over the country, ran on the Armed Forces Network and all kinds of places like that. So the ARRL started getting letters from everywhere, and they were impressed. And they've kind of been my partner in most of the films that I've done since then.
So that was produced by the ARRL. And then offered to the TV stations for free, I guess.
Say, that's right.
Here's a program you can run to help fulfill your commitments to educational programming.
That is correct.
And in those days, 16-millimeter film or maybe early videotape?
No, it was 16-millimeter film.
Yeah. I've got I've got I put this together on my YouTube channel. This is just a playlist, and this one here is the not the original Ham's Wide World. It's the ARRL version, and
yes,
I'm not sure I've got the sound set correctly here. We may or may not hear anything. No, sounds like we're not going to hear anything. This is not on the ARRL's website, but some of these programs are on the ARRL's website. And I think I got some of them from there. Let me see if I can go back to my list. Three of the five that I've got are put up there by the ARRL on their website. So some of your stuff is available on YouTube. That original program is not. It's just going to be on the DVD. But if people want to go,
yeah, but I don't know why Johns Hopkins doesn't put all of their kinescopes on YouTube. Maybe they're worried about rights and that sort of thing. Somebody coming back to them and saying, "I didn't give you any permission to put that on television," or whatever. But universities are not the fastest people generally to publicize themselves. They all try, but the history is not a long suit. The history of Johns Hopkins, not a long suit with Johns Hopkins, I wouldn't think.
That's too bad, because there's probably a lot of interesting stuff. Most of it certainly not current, and a lot of things have been learned since programs like that were developed. Just the history of the program itself can be fascinating, and at least the ham radio program is available on the DVD. So, I'm going to scarf that up as fast as I can and go watch that.
Yeah, I need to get you that DVD so you can play pieces of it. The Ham's second Ham's Wide World, which was the second film that I did in the series. Actually, I had a tough time finding a good copy of it to get onto the DVD, and it turned out that Bill Pasternak had the best copy of it.
And a projector that would play it.
We both know Bill Pasternak.
Yeah.
He recorded it while he was at KTTV at Fox. And had a good copy of it without too many scratches in it.
Yeah, Bill, by the way, I'm not sure what happened, but he has just missed his first Newsline broadcast since it began, I think, 34 years ago.
He has a medical problem of some kind, and yeah. I talked to him on the phone recently, and I'm not sure what kind it is, but it was clearly enough to have him miss his first Newsline, which I missed. I like Newsline.
Yeah. Yeah, it made me wish that I had offered sometime in the past to sort of step in, if possible, and put something together for him to get it going. I'll talk to him about that. Yeah, I have those skills.
So. You really do, and you should volunteer them.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's hard to come up with time.
Although that is so much Bill Pasternak, I'm not sure he'll ever let go of it.
Yeah. Well, this probably is one of those. Milestone or changing events that someone can say, maybe I have to now.
Yeah.
First miss has been passed. Well, we'll see. I want to get him back on. We've done some BS programs, some bull session programs, and we have fun doing those. And I've been just too busy to put one together. But early in 2015, we'll get a brain trust together and do some more of that. So when you went to do the second program, how did you decide what was going to go into that one? That one you had Dick Van Dyke.
By that time, I actually had a film distribution company. I'd made a lot of educational films. My company had a lot of educational films, teacher training films and things of that kind, and I couldn't get any of the big distributors to distribute them. So I started a film distribution company, and I realized that maybe a film for youngsters would be saleable. So I made one with a bunch of kids in it, all hams, mostly hams. And it was about 15 minutes long. It wasn't for television. It was for showing in schools. And I sold it cheap. I sold a few of them, but not many of them. That's promoting
that
ham radio.
That sounds way too familiar to me. Is that film out there anyplace?
Say it again.
Is that film out there anyplace that people can see?
It's actually on the ARL DVD, I think. This is Ham Radio. Yeah, one right there.
All right, yeah. So we can see that too on the DVD, because I don't think that one showed up on YouTube either.
It should show up on YouTube. It's got a young, I mean, in those days in California, there was a club called the Valley Amateur Radio Club, meaning the San Fernando Valley, where the average age probably of the members of that club was under 20. And there were just a lot of hams in that club, and they all participated in this little film that I made.
Yep. Well, I've done a YouTube search for This Is Ham Radio, and it's not showing up in the first page of things. So maybe it is only available there on that ARRL DVD. And maybe if we push them, they can release that stuff onto YouTube, because I don't think they're going to make a ton of money off of the DVDs, and getting the word out there as best as possible is always a good idea. So speaking of ARRL and video production, you were mentioning that it took a budget to come up with some money enough to actually get out there and produce the second version of Wide World of Amateur Radio. In that day, today it's pretty inexpensive to put equipment together. In that day, it was not cheap and it was not easy.
That's right.
It took a lot of people.
It was all 16 millimeter. And that's what all of these documentaries were shot on, was 16 millimeter film. And you had to record and then marry the two later when you put it all together in the editing room. And it was expensive. And the league came up, if I remember correctly, with $12,000. And I said to John Griggs, well, I don't know if we can include Barry Goldwater for $12,000, because we have to travel over to Arizona and all that. It's Barry Goldwater, he said. Oh, my God, can you think you can get Barry Goldwater? I think I can get extra money from the league for Barry Goldwater. That's where I learned to love breakage.
Breakage?
Breakage is a film term for when some executive comes along and says, I really like to have snow on the roof of the house. And you have to reshoot the house with snow on the roof. That wasn't in the original budget, and that's called breakage.
So that's where the extra money comes from. All right, so $12,000 doesn't seem like much. What year did you produce that?
I'm sorry, what?
$12,000 doesn't sound like much.
No, it's not. I cheated and stole.
It wasn't that much in those days, but those days were a long time ago.
Yeah, those days, yeah.
Yeah, what year did you produce that one?
Oh, God. I'm no good with history. Sorry.
It was in the 70s sometime.
In the late 60s. It was the late 60s. And I donated my own time. I never charged the league for my own time. And the only people I paid were my own employees, who was a cameraman and a sound man and a lighting man. Although we didn't take a lighting man on the Barry Goldwater shoot. I did take a still photographer who worked for practically nothing because he wanted to meet Barry Goldwater.
I don't know if you've got plans to work with the league on anything anything else coming up. The most recent program you worked on, I think Bill Pasternak was the producer of this, the DIY Magic of Amateur Radio. That was just a couple of years ago. And
yeah, I directed that, but that was a tough film.
What made it tough?
Bill produced that. Yeah, I think the best film that's been made recently of Ham Radio that I've seen or had anything to do with was the one that Walter Cronkite narrated, called Ham Radio Today.
Yeah,
which Alan Call, W6RCL, actually produced. Pasternak worked on that too. He produced it. And I directed it. And that was a really, really, really nice film, I think, partly because of Walter. The reason that it's copyrighted material and not for broadcast is that some of these clips, we don't know where they came from.
Okay. That's always dangerous.
And we didn't pay for them.
Yeah. These days in YouTube, that is way common, and people don't tend to get in a whole lot of trouble for it. But back when this was produced, it could be a bit more of a something to be, especially if you're a big reputable outfit like ARRL. But what I'm getting at is my impression is that the ARRL, and maybe because this is the case with hams in general and things that experience they've been able to witness, is not particularly new media savvy.
It's not what, Gary?
They don't warm up to new media. They don't warm up to the production capabilities that would today be within their grasp. The ARRL doesn't have a television show. I guess that's the easiest way to say it. They don't make a TV show. They make an occasional show once in a while. But I'm sitting here able to crank out a show a week or more. Ham Nation is on Twit. They do a show a week. George Thomas and his crew do Amateur Logic. They do about one a month. There's a few others that are working near that level, and then a bunch that work at a much lower YouTube-ish level. And ARRL is not making a TV show. And for a while, I thought, well, I'd kind of like to be their TV show guy. And now I realize that would have been terrible. I would have been very unhappy because I would have had to do things they wanted to get done. And I'd much rather do things I want to get done. But they're still not. And they don't even have a little studio where they can present someone up at headquarters into my show or into Ham Nation or Amateur Logic as a guest from ARRL headquarters. When I get someone on, they are sitting with a laptop on their desk, looking up their nose, with the background being the lights on the ceiling, like most people do on YouTube or on Skype. And as we fixed for you, as you put together a good background for this show. So
I would love to have the ARRL move into the 21st century in that regard. I've grown weary of pushing on them. New media is not something I think that the ARRL is going to embrace unless somebody comes along with a huge amount of money to give to them specifically for their own television channel. And there are a few people around who could afford to do that. I unfortunately am not one of them, but the league has a very good fundraising organization, but they have a lot of things to spend money on too. And so I don't think that I don't know what it would take to talk them into their own television channel, although I do think, and I haven't heard it before except from you just now, I do think it's a terrific idea.
I don't think it's just the folks at the league that don't get doing that. I think it is the hams of our generation that don't get doing that. And if we want to attract, we keep saying we want to attract a new generation of hams in the teens and 20s, that's where their media is. It's not expensive to do. I don't think it would take someone donating a lot of money. Look at this, not that shot. There we go. Here's my studio. A couple of cameras, a computer with Wirecast, a little sound mixer, and not very much other stuff. I think I have, over the 10 years or so I've been putting this together, a total outlay of less than $50,000. Probably a lot less, especially if I throw away the stuff that I don't use anymore because it's old standard definition equipment. And just look at the high def stuff. It's probably more like $25,000. So I think that's probably something that the league ought to be able to afford.
Oh, they can definitely afford that. What they really need, in addition to that, and that studio of yours is certainly a start, would be a small television studio at the league headquarters, so that when dignitaries show up there, they can be interviewed for the Ham Channel by somebody from league headquarters,
yeah,
who knows something about them. And the rest of the time, ham radio videos could run on it, and they could promote them. The biggest problem with ham radio videos is it's damn near impossible to promote them.
Well, the ARRL has got the best promotion vehicle that anyone else in ham radio has got, in QST Magazine. You need a little lead time if you're going to get the folks, get something in the magazine. You need a couple months of lead time. But they could continuously develop an online presence so that they've got something that's more immediate. They would need something besides the hardware. They'd need someone who knows how to make something work within it. They would need some somewhat charismatic on-camera talent. You don't want to do all just talk shows. You want to be able to get out in the field and be able to show stuff that's happening. So there you start building up some time and money.
You could have a couple of cameras in W1AW and just run W1AW is doing for filler.
Yeah, and that would be the place to build your studio. Building a set would probably be a big mistake. Making one of the on-air studios at W1AW into their television studio,
sure,
would be the thing to do. It would just be some audio mixing and lighting and cameras.
Gary, I think you've just started a campaign.
Well, we'll take somebody out there to follow up on this, because they're not listening to me. Maybe they're watching this. So anyway, I think that it's been a missed bet for a long time up at league headquarters, and hopefully it won't be missed for too much longer. I mean, they make an equipment review video every now and then, so they've got a nice camera. They didn't do much at the national convention last summer. An opportunity for a lot of program fodder. I've done that sort of thing at Dayton and other places where you've got a lot of people, a lot of big shots around, and try to put that stuff together. But and maybe they look at the success or lack of it that others who have been trying, like me and other people, and said, it's not there yet. It's not worth doing. There won't be the audience. I don't know. You're probably familiar with the series of DVDs that CQ put together back in the early 90s.
I am, yeah.
Yeah. And they produced those. It was in the era when they had to do the serious television production, a three-man crew, a producer, a sound guy, a camera operator. I think they did their own lighting. Expensive to cart around. A lot of editing and all that stuff afterwards. So things like that are a lot easier to do these days, but CQ only did that once, and probably for a good reason. I don't think it worked for them. I don't think they made significant amount of money.
No, I think they lost money on those.
Yeah,
probably. Looked like they were expensive losers.
They were thoroughly professional.
Yeah, they were good, but hard to get people to buy that kind of stuff.
Yeah. And they were aimed at hams. They weren't aimed at the general public. They were aimed at, most of them aimed at new hams, were at getting people into ham radio as opposed to just showing people ham radio.
Right.
And I don't think it went anywhere. Maybe the league is still looking at those and saying it didn't go. But we're in a different world now. Distribution is free. YouTube is free. more controlled distribution where you can have a channel. It's going to cost you some money, but it's still not astronomically expensive, although it's too expensive for me. I can't buy my own channel yet. Well, I was kind of wondering where you'd want to, what you'd think about this new media thing. I mean, you're an old fogey. You're like retired and stuff. So you could have told me you never even watched a YouTube show, and I'd believe you.
I watch YouTube all the time, actually. Not all the time. I watch it with some regularity, particularly when I hear about something on there that I may be interested in. Once again, YouTube's got millions of programs, probably literally millions of programs, and you got to be a little bit smarter than I am to figure out exactly how to find them. But I can find some. Friends of mine who are very web savvy send me links to things on YouTube, which is very helpful. And I've got a bunch of old films that I've produced that are sitting on the shelf, which I'm going to try and get on YouTube myself as kind of a retirement gig of sorts. And then, of course, I'm promoting my book this year. This is my year to promote the book and to be on the air. One of the things that I've done, Gary, just for your information, is that I belong to several, the hell are they called, where you get N1MM sends you all of the emails that they get, and Elecraft sends you all the emails that they get. I've dumped those. I don't get those anymore. If I want to know something about N1MM that I can't figure out, the logging program, I'll go on and find it on the website rather than read 10,000 emails a day from people who are asking questions.
You're learning how to make this web thing work for you.
Yeah.
As opposed to drive your life.
I need time to promote my book, and I need time to be on the air, and that's exactly what I'm going to be doing.
Where can people find you on the air? You hang out any place?
What's that again?
Do you hang out any place on the air in particular, nets or whatever?
Well, interestingly enough, I've just discovered PSK31. My friend Brad Field, WHAJO, has been on that ever since it started, and he is exclusively on that. And I had an opportunity to be W1AW Portable 6 running PSK31, a friend of mine, K6YR, roped me into that. And so I hooked up PSK31 and made a bunch of people happy getting a W1AW centennial contact on PSK31. And I really enjoyed it. So I think I'm going to be spending a lot of time on 14070.
Okay, so if people want to talk to W6AQ, that's a place to go, at least a good opportunity to the best opportunity to find you. That W1AW portable thing has just been phenomenally successful.
It has been a great internal promotion for the league.
I don't think that they would have had any idea that every time a new state came on, it would generate the kind of pileups that it did.
They admit that they had no idea it was going to be so popular. They admit that. It was just surprised the hell out of them that it was so popular.
Yeah. And see, even some of the secondary parts of that campaign, which are just directors and officials getting on the air, have been able to generate pileups. People would have
That's right.
a higher points value than like me, a PIO, get on and call CQ and announce their position, and they'll generate pileups. So it's been awesome. I've been able to work a lot of the W1AW portable stations just by turning on a radio and dialing around a little bit, because it's usually somebody with a big signal somewhere, and get into the pileup and keep threading my way through until I get through. I haven't been officially trying to see how many states that I've worked. I'm probably at like 30 or 35, and so I'm not going to do a worked all states with them. But just the easy turn the radio on, dial across a band, and there they are. And their volunteers have been great because they've been easy to find, and most of them very good operators working through those pileups quickly.
That's right. That's right. And I shouldn't admit this, but I had no idea really how to run PSK 31 1 week before I was due to go on the air with but so I did succeed with it.
You learned fast.
Well, it's a great deal simpler media, a great deal simpler mode than I would have thought.
Yeah, and it's easy on the ears.
And I think I'm going to really enjoy it. It's easy on the ears. You don't have to have the volume up at all. All you got to do is read a few comments from whoever you're talking to, and hopefully not just send back a bunch of packets, but actually think of something to say, like the good old days on CW.
Yeah, not too many F keys with automated responses. You can sit there and type.
Right.
So is there another TV show in your future, or do you think you're going to rest on your laurels?
Well, I'm going on I'm planning some kind of a PSK-31D expedition. I'm not sure where I'm going to go. I think I'm going to take, I have kids that live in Hawaii, so I think I'm going to take the boat from Los Angeles to Hawaii and do PSK-31 from the boat. If they won't let me do that boat, I'm going to try maybe one of the Viking cruises, one of the rivers in Europe, since the navigation on those rivers looks to me to be pretty simple. I don't think that I was going to worry about destroying his radar or whatever. And I don't know. I'm thinking about going to Friedrichshafen, the big Dayton ham radio convention of Europe again next summer. Maybe I'll make it. Maybe I won't. I'm going to do a field day next summer. Don't know from where. Anyway, I got lots of plans and hope they all come true.
So it sounds like what you're thinking of is the things that you'll be doing. You'll bring a camera along and document them, and then a simple edit and makes a show.
Yeah, I don't know if I'll do that or not. I may, if I get permission to operate PSK-31 on a Viking riverboat, I'll probably buy a new iPhone and make movies with the iPhone.
Yeah, I guess that's the easy way to do it. And there are tons and tons and tons of ham radio videos out there on YouTube. Figuring out which ones are worth spending your time with can be difficult. But most of them are pretty short. And you can tell pretty quick if it's going someplace that you want. Right. But you do have the book tour, the international book tour that is coming up.
Yeah, the international book tour, yeah. Well, I'm going to be in Dayton. I'll be at the, and I'll sign books. Anybody that's got a book, I'll be happy to sign it. And they can get them from the ARRL at Dayton and probably from DX Engineering at Dayton.
So you'll probably be back at the ARRL Expo area doing the book signing?
What's that again?
You'll be back at their Expo area doing the book signing? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I'll do a book signing back there. I'm even thinking about sitting around the lobby of a few of the hotels selling books, but I'm not going to sell my own books. That's too much work. I didn't get into that writing game to become a salesman. But I hope I get other people to promote it and sell it, and I'll be happy to sign your book.
Yeah, it is a fun book to read. You're a good writer. It is not purely a linear narrative. You go back and forth. And the humor is subtle. It's not knock you over the head, you know, jokes type humor. But every once in a while, a sentence comes in there that just goes, "Ha, yeah." So I'm having a good time going through it. I don't read a lot of books because when I try, I end up being up until 3 o'clock in the morning, not able to put them down. So it's going to be a late night finishing this one off.
I'm going. You've looked at some of my book. I tried consciously for the humor. I love humor. There's not enough humor in the world, God knows. And ham radio is not a real serious hobby.
Oh, yes, it is. Oh, no, ham radio is very serious. Stop having fun.
Right. Well, it can get serious in emergencies, but other than that, it's kind of fun.
Yep.
I look at ham radio as the fun a great fun hobby that anybody ever came along with.
All right. Well, it has been a pleasure talking to you here. We've encountered each other mostly at Dayton, I think, but haven't known each other well. For people who have traveled, not exactly parallel paths, but paths within the media and ham radio, probably should have known each other better for a long time. I don't know.
Well, you're right. And we'll have to make a date for dinner at Dayton.
Yeah, that would be great. Of course, I've known your buddy Bill Pasternak for a long time.
Everybody has known Bill Pasternak for a long time.
Yes, I'm afraid so. All right, well, thank you very much for this, and we'll get it on. And it's too late for Christmas for anyone to get the paperback version to anybody, because it's only a couple days till Christmas. But if you want to buy them the Kindle version, it's better than Dave thought it was. You can blow the pictures up, and they look pretty good. So, and it'll save you some money, a lot of money, unfortunately.
But the Kindle version can't be autographed.
That's true. I could have you autograph the cover of my Nexus 7. Not sure how well that would come out, but it's worth a try, I suppose. So I need to mention. Oh yes.
A lot. It's been great fun. Really has.
I need to mention that this program is brought to you by you, not necessarily you, Dave, but you, the television audience. That fella sitting back on the shelf there is Arvin, the Ham Radio Now mascot. And his icon appears here at the bottom of the screen. I can't ever remember whether it's this side or that side. You click on hamradionow.tv and click on Arvin's icon, take you to our contribution page. We've done okay this year, a little bit better than last year. It's not a business, it's not a living, but it's way more than a little hobby. I like it to be more of a living than it is. And the more I get from you, the more I'm able to do. So if you want me more than just sitting here talking to people like Dave on Skype, which is fun, but people like the road shows, the field produced stuff as well, then HamRadioNow.tv is the place to make that happen. 73, Dave, good talking to you. I'll see you at Dayton probably for sure.
73, the AQs have to stick together and never forget that.
We do. The way this program ends is by really bad radio procedure, but something that I got from Dick Tracy, and I am going to say it now. Over and out.
But most of all, in the here and now, our hobby gives us the world, a world of learning and helping others and just plain having fun. Is this frequency clear? This is W6RO.